Okay, this problem deals with the reactor design of a CSTR. And this is a particular type of problem that sometimes seems to be more difficult, but actually which in some ways is simpler in terms of the number of calculations that you have to do. And in this type of problem, what we're given is the conversion of A that's measured at a given initial set of conditions. And then in these types of problems, what we're going to do is make a change to those conditions. And here we're told that the volumetric flow rate into the process is increased by a factor of 1.5, right, leaving everything else constant. We want to know how this value of the conversion actually changes. And what you notice in this problem is that we're really not given much information beyond this, except that the equilibrium conversion of A under the same conditions is 80%, and that we have equimolar amounts of A and B. And so, for example, we don't know in this problem what the volume of the reactor is. And even though, for example, we're told that the volumetric flow rate goes up by a factor of 1.5, we don't know what that initial volumetric flow rate is. We'll see that we can actually still solve this problem in part by taking it on faith that we'll be able to solve for a group of parameters that we can lump together, and we'll see that we can call that number the Damkohler number, and that those parameters, all except for one, won't change, and that one that will change is the volumetric flow rate, and we'll be able to account for that. So let's see how this works. The first thing we notice is that this is a reversible reaction. We're achieving a conversion of 60%, which is approaching the equilibrium conversion. And so we should consider this an equilibrium reaction. And that means we're going to need to solve for a equilibrium constant in this case. Okay, and so solving for the equilibrium constant is fairly straightforward, right? That this is a second order reaction, we're told that is elementary, right? And so we can express the concentration-based equilibrium constant in terms of the concentration of the product squared over the concentrations of the reactants at equilibrium. And we can furthermore express this in terms of conversion. So for every mole of A that's converted, we convert one mole of B, and we're told that we start with equimolar feeds. And then we produce 2 moles of C. And so therefore we plug in 1 minus x, which is the conversion of A, for each concentration value to get a 1 minus x squared in the denominator. And we plug in a 2x for C, since we form 2 moles of C for each mole of A, and square that to get 4x squared. All right, and we're told that the equilibrium conversion is 80%, so we can plug in the 0.8 for x, and that allows us to solve for the equilibrium constant as being equal to 64. Okay, the next step in this problem is to set up a material balance. I'll express this here, that the typical material balance for a CSTR written in terms of conversion is here. So V over FA naught is equal to X over the rate of reaction. And then since this is an elementary reaction, we can express the rate of consumption of A as a rate constant times the product of the concentrations of A and B minus the concentration of C squared, since two C molecules have to react, divided by the equilibrium constant. And now we know this value is equal to 64. All right, we see that we have sort of a mixed expression here. We have a conversion variable in the numerator and concentration variables in the denominator. And so we'd like to express concentrations again in terms of conversion. We've already done this here for the equilibrium conversion, and it actually turns out to be, of course, the same expressions for the conversion when you're not at equilibrium. And so we can write out the expression that CA and CB are both equal to 1 minus x times CA naught. I write that out, for example, CA is just equal to CA naught times 1 minus x, and that's what CB is also equal to, since they're in equimolar quantities and are consumed at the same rate. And CC is equal to 2 times CA naught x. Okay, and so when we plug those expressions in here, we get this expression to the right, and now all of our values are, or all of our unknowns in terms of the concentration have been expressed in terms of a single variable conversion. All right, and under the initial conditions, we know that value of the conversion. It's measured to be 60%. And so we can plug in 0.6 for the conversion here, here, and here. And we know the value of Kc, which is 64. All right, so we know a lot of the terms over here on the right-hand side of the equation. And so what we'll do is multiply through both sides of the equation by kCa naught squared so that we pull a kCa naught squared over to this side. Okay, and we'll be able to solve for all the terms on the right-hand side, and we'll just lump all of these terms that we can't solve for on the left-hand side. All right, so I've done that here, and I've made an additional substitution that FA naught is equal to the volumetric flow rate times CA naught, which allows us to cancel out one of those CA naught terms. All right, this number is a dimensionless quantity that's known as the Damkohler number. And we can, again, plug in values for 60% conversion and the value of the equilibrium constant of 64 to get that this lumped term is equal to 4.36. All right, so this describes this lumped term for the initial operation where the conversion is 60%. All right, and now the question we want to ask is if nothing else changes except for the volumetric flow rate into the process, which is here, then the only variable that will change in our original expression is the conversion. So in other words, we don't expect if we operate under the same temperature, K should be constant, the rate constant. CA naught, we expect to be constant. We're still feeding the same fluids under the same conditions. We're just feeding them faster, so they're not any more or less concentrated. And we're using the same reactor, so the volume remains the same. And so therefore, the only thing that can change to balance out the increase that we're going to have in the volumetric flow rate is x in this equation. All right, and so x will no longer be 60%. It will be some, it turns out, lower value that allows the volumetric flow rate to increase. And so if we write this out, this second Damkohler number is equal to the original Damkohler number, just divided by 1.5. So in other words, 2/3 of the original Damkohler number of 4.36, which is equal to 2.91. And then we can set that equal to this same expression over here. Okay, remember we've already multiplied through by kCa naught squared to get the Damkohler number. All right, so we can set that equal to the same number over here in terms of an unknown x to solve for the conversion that we need to solve for. Okay, so finally, if we solve for that value of x, and this is most easily done using, you either need to use the quadratic formula because there are squared terms in here, or a solving calculator, get x of equal to 0.55. All right, so it goes down as expected. It maybe doesn't go down, even though we're increasing the volumetric flow rate by 1.5 so that the space time in the reactor is only 2/3 of what it was before. We only get a pretty small drop in the conversion from 60 to 55%. All right, and that's because we're pretty significantly limited by equilibrium here. So we have very nonlinear performance in the reactor since 60% is pretty close to the 80% conversion. Okay, the main point in this problem, though, is that you can see that even when we don't know everything about a reactor, as long as we can assume in analyzing any changes that several of the parameters are constant, so we're not changing everything at once, we really don't need to know all the different constants associated with a reactor. All right, we can just keep track of the ones that change in order to solve for the unknown that we need to solve the problem.